I'm Iain, and this is my new Yankee Workshop mug. And what's in my new Yankee Workshop mug is a whole lot of nothing. Because I need to fix this coffee maker so I can make some coffee to put in the new Yankee Workshop mug. And some people are addicted to coffee, and that's okay. I'm addicted to coffee makers. And more importantly, I'm addicted to collecting percolators. And this little 3-cup electric percolator is just a cute little thing. It's tiny. It's not much bigger than the new Yankee Workshop mug itself. And what's really cool about this one is it came in this little case with a little container for sugar, a little container for milk, color-coded spoons and knives. This kit is missing the 2 little coffee cups that would go with it, but this whole thing would go in the case like that, and then you could have emergency coffee wherever you went. The cord tucks in there and everything. So I bought this thing because, like I said, I really like percolators, and I had never seen an electric percolator this small before, and I went to use it this morning, and it just kept perking and perking and perking and perking. Luckily, I tried it with water first because I wasn't sure it was going to work, and sure enough, it worked a little too well. So what we need to do is take this thing apart and figure out why is it not shutting off. But before we take it apart and fix this thing, let's take a look at how a percolator makes coffee so that way we know what this thing's supposed to do and I can go over what it's not doing. In order to fix the percolator, we must first understand the percolator. So I drew this picture of a percolator so we can talk about how it works. And so once we know how it works, we can figure out what's up with this thing. This is an electric percolator. So it's slightly different than a stovetop one in the base, because the base of a stovetop one doesn't have any of this stuff in it. But that's a topic for another day. This one is electric, so here it is. Power cord plugs into the wall, pretty self-explanatory. It's got 2 prongs on the back of the percolator that it plugs into. A lot of times issues you end up having are plug related, where this plugs in, it burns away at the contacts, or they loosen up the prongs in here, or sometimes the little spring-loaded contacts in here wear out. So first thing to do is make sure the cord is okay, and when in doubt, replace the cord with a new one and just check to make sure that doesn't fix it. So once the power gets to here, we have some wires and we have a heater that surrounds this little, I'm calling it a well. It's a little dent in the bottom of the actual percolator. So we've got the base here, we've got the actual yellow part of the percolator there that the water goes down in. Now, this Empire one is actually the exact opposite. It doesn't have a well. It has the heating element come up inside the thing, and where this little flare is at the bottom of the stem is actually much bigger in this thing, and it covers the heating element. So it's like the well is upside down, but 90% of them have the well like this, so I drew it like this. Just understand, this does the same thing, it's just inside out. So, heating element in the center of it, not under anywhere else, just the center, with a well. Above the well, you have a stem that covers up the well and has a tiny little hole in it, because you need to get water from this part down into the well, and it trickles in through the little hole, fills up the well and the stem up to whatever the water level is. So we've got water in here, heating element around here. Over here, we have a bimetallic thermostat that at a certain temperature, There are two metals on that bottom contact right there that are fused together, and they expand at different rates. So once the heat gets to a certain level, it warps enough that it opens up those contacts. When the contacts open up, current stops flowing through the heating element, it stops getting hot. And so then, as things cool down a little bit, it closes again, heats up again, opens up again, and it'll keep the coffee at a constant temperature. It also keeps it from just perking forever and turning this thing into some sort of muddy sludge that used to be coffee. So, water is in this stem. This has not hit the temperature where it shuts off yet, so current's flowing through this heating element. The heating element's getting hot, as heating elements tend to do. This water in this well is getting really, really hot. At some point, it flashes over to steam, and it expands. Because steam expands, it pushes this column of water up and out the top. So it launches the water up and out the top of the stem into the little glass knob at the top of this thing, and it hits the top of the basket. The basket is where all the coffee grounds go. And so it drips through the basket, through the coffee grounds, out the bottom of the basket, because there's a whole bunch of holes in it, and it rains down on top of the water in the coffee pot part of this. Because the water in the stem and the water from the well, whatever didn't get turned into steam when it launched out here, is really hot now, it stays up at the top. So you get this layer of coffee riding on the top of just water, cold water at that point. Now, you might be saying, well, why does it launch out the top when you've got a little hole here? Doesn't it want to expand everywhere? Yeah, and a little bit of it does go back out that hole, but that's a tiny hole versus a much larger stem. The bulk of that water takes the path of least resistance and just gets launched out the top. Once it launches the water out the top and all that's left is steam in here, the water is heavier than the steam. It can actually just squash the steam out the top, and it starts refilling this well and the stem with cold water. It's rushing in faster than this heating element can boil it off, so it stops boiling for a second, fills it up with a second round of cold water, sits in there for a little bit, starts to boil, and launches again. That's why you'll see when these things are perking, it's a spurt and then a pause. Spurt and then a pause, because it launches a charge of hot water out the stem, cold water rushes in, cools everything off. It takes a second for it to heat that charge of water back up, turn it to steam, and launch it back out. So most of the water in the well and in the stem is not boiling. It's just right at the layer of where the well is near the heating elements that boils, and it just pushes the rest of the water up and out. Because if it was just steam, it really wouldn't work, because it would all come out the lid and you wouldn't get any coffee. So as it goes, another layer of hot water and coffee rain down on this thing. And eventually, because it's always sucking in the coldest water, launching it up, eventually it's going to cycle through all this water and heat up the entire thing. Once everything's gone through the thing once, and everything's good and hot, and you can actually feel this phenomenon happening when it's going, if you put your hand on this, be careful that you don't burn yourself, but if you time it right, you can actually feel it'll be hot up here, still cool to the touch down here, and it'll gradually, the whole thing will heat up. Once it all heats up, this thermostat starts to heat up. And then, eventually, the water is hot enough down here, because it's worked its way down, to open up that thermostat, and it stops perking. So it should sit there and perk, 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 for a few minutes, and then eventually you should hear a little click, and it should stop. Ta-da, you made coffee. Well, this thing just sits there and perks, 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 and I let it go for a good 12 minutes, which is a ridiculous amount of time for a 3-cup coffee maker. And it was just going absolutely nuts. So, I think the switch is bad. I think it's stuck. So with that, let's take this thing apart and see just what there is to see in the bottom of one of these things. I figured you probably want to see what's actually inside this thing besides just my super crude drawing of a percolator. So you got the lid, the little glass knob at the top. Oops, there we go. We've got a basket. Now most of these have a little lid that goes on the basket, and the idea behind that is it just helps keep the coffee in the basket when you're pouring this thing so it doesn't come out the top. Also, another theory is that it helps make the water go down through it more evenly when it comes launching out this stem right here. But either way, some of them don't have the top, and that seems to be okay. You've got the little basket. It's got holes in it. You just put the coffee in. No, you don't need a filter with these things, although they did used to make percolator filters that were donut-shaped if you really wanted a filter for your percolator. So you take the basket out, and you've got a stem. And so this is just the stem. There's the little hole I was talking about. This one has a double layer flare thing at the bottom, and what this does is it gets water trapped in there, and it acts as insulation to help heat up the water inside this thing faster than the water around the outside. So that's kind of a cool thing. And then down at the bottom, that's, like I said, this thing, this forms the well on top of the heating element. It's inside out compared to 90% of percolators. There's a depression at the bottom, and this thing's much flatter, and it just covers the hole. Here, the heating element sticks up inside this thing, and this goes down over it. So it's just a different setup. It does the same thing. Okay, so this thing, the bottom of it, says Empire, the Metalware Corp. Two Rivers, Wisconsin, 120 volts, 435 watts, do not immerse, well, duh, and AC only, catalog numbered, blah, blah, blah. So it's a little percolator. It's just a little baby electric percolator. Has one nut on the bottom that you take off, and we should be able to get this base to come off. Hey, look at that. So, we have the prongs, the little insulator that holds them in place for the cord. We have wires going into the heating element that's right under this thing. And we have ourselves the thermostat with the bimetallic switch to it. And if we take a look at this thing, and I will try and zoom in. I don't know how well this is going to show up on camera, so I'll try and explain it the best I can. There's a little brass screw right here with very fine threads screwed into this plate. And then there's some sort of high temperature plastic piece right there that actually pushes on the bimetallic spring to hold those contacts together. And the reason for the screw is so you can adjust the temperature that this thing regulates at. So that's kind of cool. But I should be able to pull these contacts apart. And I don't know if the camera can pick up on that or not. But when I pull down on it, it's actually wedging, or it's actually pulling that top piece with it. So these are good and welded together. And that happens to contacts on occasion. So what I need to do is get a knife that I can put in there and see if I can just very gently break these things apart. So let me go find a knife. Well, I found a knife. It's a very cheap knife. And sometimes it's good to have cheap knives for just such occasions when you don't want to risk damaging a better knife. If I go in here, I should be able to very, very carefully break these things apart. There. I think I did. Yep. There. So they're freed up. Now what I want to do is back this screw out to take the tension off, and I'm just going to take a little bit of really fine sandpaper and clean up those contacts. And the way I like to clean up contacts like this, a lot of people, everybody's got their own idea for what's the best way to clean up contacts, whether it's contact cleaner and a piece of cardboard, or emery cloth, or sandpaper. Everybody's got their own idea, and they're all very good ideas. They all accomplish the same thing. This was really well welded. So at that point, the cardboard with contact cleaner on it, it's usually past that point at this stage, because it had some really big weld marks on it. So what I like to do is stick a little bit of sandpaper in between. Gotta loosen up this screw. This screw is left-hand thread, by the way, in case you're playing along at home. Close it up. So I open it up with the screw to put the sandpaper in. Then I put just a little bit of tension on it, and I go ahead and clean it up. There. Now I will open up again, still remembering it's left-hand thread. And what I'll do is I'll take some contact cleaner and hose it out so any of the junk from the sandpaper gets washed out of there. There. And then I shake the spare contact cleaner on the floor where it belongs, and it's all better. Okay, we're going to test this thermostat now that it's been cleaned up and I put a little bit of tension on it, just to make sure that it actually opens up. We won't know if it's at the right temperature until I try to make some coffee with this thing, and that just takes a little trial and error. But we'll at least know it can snap open when it heats up. And to heat it up, I've got the super amazing $10, I can't believe it doesn't start fires, heat gun from Harbor Freight, and I'm using the Harbor Freight multimeter, because people seem to really like it when I fix stuff using real basic stuff, and you can't get any more basic than super cheap multimeter and $10 heat gun from Harbor Freight. Although, this is the deluxe model. It has the backlight LCD. Woo. Okay, I'm just going to heat up the thermostat, and we should see the resistance jump up to infinity when it snaps open. What could possibly go wrong? Yep. There we go. As it cools down, we should see it reconnect. In theory, eventually. Today. There we go. It's back. So, it can actually open up and close back up the way it's supposed to. Don't know if it's set right. Like I said, that's just going to be me trying to make coffee with it and see what it does. But at least we know it can open and close again, so it should do something. I'm going to say this repair was a success. So, ta-da. But the real question is, does it make coffee? So let's see what this thing can do. Put that in like that. Fire in the hole. Well, I can touch it without getting zapped, so that's a good sign. We should see water come launching up out of that stem. Ooh, it's done. That's some pretty weak coffee right there. But it does prove that the thermostat works again. I just gotta fine tune it a little bit. So, it went from making sludge to really weak coffee, so I'm going to consider this thing fixed. I just got to play with it a little bit to get it dialed in to making good coffee.